3 years of retreat meditating. No vision of Maitreya. That's the statue of Maitreya, that statue in the back. You know, sitting there. He always sits with his legs like this because he's going to, the idea is he's going to come into the world in the future. He doesn't sit with a meditative cross leg, but with the legs down. And so it's a tradition of the of Maitreya iconography. And no sign of Maitreya for 3 years. So he became discouraged and he was leaving. And on his way down, not far from the cave, he saw a man he had not seen there before, who was, I guess, somebody else had taught him natural rights or something. He was there for 3 years. And the man was rubbing a lump of iron with a piece of pulse. And like a little round lump of iron, right, with like the finger thing around, he was rubbing with the pulse. So Sankar was kind of intrigued by this. He's like, what are you doing? And the guy said, I'm making a needle. He said, you can't make a needle rubbing iron with a piece of cloth. What is with you? And really, the guy says, and he held up a little dish with like a dozen needles in it. And I made these. Oh, okay, I get the message. And he says, I need to be more persistent, more have to take over. He goes back to the cave. 3 more years. No, still no action. He's leaving the cave again. And this time he sees a bird making a nest on a ledge and a rock. And its feathers, wing feathers, brush the rock where it's landing with twigs and things to make the nest. And he notices that where the wing brushes the rock is cut in by a feather going on for generations of birds. Oh, okay, get the message, go back. 3 more years. 9 years out, no Maitreya. He's again leaving. Again, this time he sees water dripping on the on a rock. It's made a big bowl in the rock, a huge bowl of dripping water. All right, okay, long time. Finally, 12 years, still no Maitreya. He gets disgusted, he leaves. Doesn't look left or right. Says, I'm not going to take any signs. I'm not going to. This is ridiculous. Maybe there is no future Buddha. Maybe it's all a scam. Maybe it's all nonsense. I still do like my monastery. Maybe I'll go back and sweep the floor of the monastery. So, or something. Right? And he's wandering aimlessly. And he comes to the first town, probably in Maharashtra. And there he's in the dump outside the town. And there he sees a dog. And for some reason they emphasize a female dog. And this dog is like, if you've been in India or Mexico, it's good enough. You sometimes dogs are in a rather sorry state. And this one was in an extremely bad state. And it had practically gangrene. It's like this. So he's like looking at the dog. He's dog, this dog is coming up to him, whining. And he says, well, I'm kind of useless. I'm barking up the wrong tree, on the wrong path. Maybe I can do something for this dog. So then he comes and takes a look, and the dog's hindquarters are all covered, or all the flesh is all rotten. And there are maggots in the flesh already, although the dog is alive, but it has maggots growing in the flesh. So he thinks, well, okay, I'll clean the dog and clean up the infection, you know, scrape it off, and fix it, and then, you know, I'll take it in and find a vet. In the 4th century. So then he goes and he's about to clean off the maggots, and he kind of gets into the maggots. And he says, the maggots are like maggots, you know, they're like, the little maggots, the little maggot faces, and he's in it. So, and he said, oh, I can't kill all these maggots. What can I do with the maggots? So, I know what I'm doing. So he finds a shard of an old sort of pottery, something with sharp edge, on the ground in the dump. And he cuts a piece of flesh, a strip of flesh off his thigh. And he prices it off. And he says, the guy's in serious condition. His endorphins are apparently functioning like a fasting person. So he cuts this piece of flesh off and he puts it down on the ground next to the dog. And then he's going to pick the maggots off, put them on the piece of flesh, and then carry the piece of flesh in some place, I don't know, the maggot house, whatever. You know what he's going to do? He's not even sure himself, but he's going to keep them alive and take them off the dog. And then he's going, but then he can't, it's hard to pick up squirmy maggots. He doesn't want to squish them. So he's like, and they're not coming up to his fingers. So he gets a final bright idea. Okay, I'll go down and I'll put my tongue out, which is kind of more juicy than my finger. And the tongue flesh is more vital and lively than the own flesh. So they'll jump on my tongue, and then one by one, I'll put them on the piece of meat. They go down, and the tongue's sticking out. When he gets near the dog, he closes his eyes. It's like a bit funky. And then I get in the tongue. And suddenly, like there's a bang, like an electronic sound. Bing, sound like this. He's jumping back. And there's the Maitreya. The Buddha Maitreya is standing there. Standing one, I'm just saying, but looking like that. With a golden, multi-red-hued rainbow aura. All of it, like really nice. So he's, oh wow, Maitreya, you know, and he bows, because it's the future Buddha, but he's also human, so he's just coming up from the first bow, and he's saying, my lord, you know, it's great to see you, but where have I been for 12 years? And he's still bowing, and he's still complaining. So then Maitreya says, well, what do you mean where have I been? Who was making needles? Who was making this? Who was the dripping wart? I've been with you the whole time. But you know, until this moment, you had no compassion. You didn't have universal compassion. Well, you had compassion, of course. You didn't have universal compassion. Messianic compassion. Mahakarma. He said, and without universal compassion, you can't really see love. Because Maitreya is from Mitra, Maitri, which means love in Sanskrit. So his name is Maitreya, the loving Buddha. And he's called that because at the time when he comes in the world is not in as bad a way as it was when Shakyamuni came, with a lot of militarism, a lot of Peloponnesian wars, you know, etc. and things. And so people don't need like a warrior. Shakyamuni is more of a warrior. So then he's looking very dubious that he was here all the time and I didn't have compassion enough and whatever. So he says, look, I know you don't really believe me, but take me to town and you'll see. So he takes the glowing ball of light, it's like a little ball of light like this, and he picks up this ball of light, orb of light, puts it on his shoulder, and runs into town. Rejoice, rejoice, the future Buddha is here. Well, he's here, like Buddha's not with us. And then pretty soon people are pelting him with rocks. Because what they see is a loony-looking guy who's very scrawny, after 12 years, bleeding on the leg, with a rotten dog on his shoulder, saying, rejoice, rejoice, here's the future Buddha. So then he kind of realizes that they don't see this Maitreya themselves. And then he's sort of dejectedly leaving town, and driven out. And then one elderly woman who was a charwoman at the charnel ground, she just sees a jeweled foot on a jeweled lotus, like a tube made of jeweled plasma. And then the dog, but the dog has this jeweled Maitreya Buddha foot. But then she offers a flower to the thing, and Maitreya says, you see, so some people can see. You know, don't despair. And then Maitreya, so here it is, you know, the dog and a sangha, and then the dog turns into Maitreya, and then they go to town and people chase them away. And then up here he's flying, and then Maitreya takes it. Then Maitreya says, now you come with me. This is typical Tibetan story. Actually, typical Buddhist story. So Maitreya says, well, come with me to where I dwell, which is in the Tushita heaven, which is where the people who are going to be Buddhas have their last life as a Bodhisattva in that particular heaven. And they have a Dharma center in that heaven. Most of the gods in that heaven are just, you know, wasting their time in their thousand-year jacuzzis and, you know, have the parties and they're wasting their time. But there is a Dharma center in the heaven, and some of them come to that, and that's where the Buddha teaches. But until they come to earth, you know, it's like a tradition. It's the fourth heaven up in the desire realm plane of heaven, the sixth desire realm of heaven, and there's called Tushita. Tushita means satisfaction, the heaven of complete satisfaction. So So he takes him up there to that heaven with the Maitreya does. So here he's in his heaven. And then, this is the typical thing, this is the part line. He then sits him down and he dictates five books to him. And he writes them down. So they're kind of mediumistic channel books. They're like the Course in Miracles, you know, which was channeled at Columbia University about 20, 30 years ago, if anybody knows what that is. And it's a channel book. So the Maitreya, now according to the Buddhists, now the Japanese scholars were like going around India with a magnifying glass and looking for a gravestone of a human being called Maitreya. You know, they thought this was some myth made up by the Indians, and actually there was a person right there who lived in a town called Fushitai. But they couldn't find any such thing, and even the Chinese Buddhists, everybody agrees that it was Maitreya who took it to heaven and the general thing. And then, in the when he taught the books, the five books, he would come, Maitreya would come down in a form, but only a Sangha could see him. So he would ask, So the students, Vasubandhu and the other great pundits, great masters, would ask Asanga questions about this new version of the Mahayana teaching, and Asanga would ask Maitreya, and then he would transmit that question and answer it. So again, that was like a mediumistic experience, apparently, at the time. And this translation is a translation of the root text, Mahayana Sutra Alankara, it's called. And it was the first book that we did of our project to translate the entire collection of in Tibet, of what was once the library of the great university of Nalanda. You know, it's like the library of Alexandria in India, lost in India, later burned down by invaders, and except for a few scrap manuscripts here and there, and then preserved in a very excellent Tibetan translation. But although this particular one there was a Sanskrit version kept in Nepal, and there was a Chinese translation. So there were three versions that we used in making this translation. The Sanskrit one from Nepal, the Tibetan one, and the Nepalese one. I mean the Chinese one. So that's the story. Isn't that a cute story? I like that story. It's like, you know, it shows that universal compassion is this thing, but people just feel the feeling of the other being. And it doesn't necessarily, without what they call skill in liberative technique, or skill in liberative art, to how to go about helping. I mean, like, for example, if somebody could have started a branch of the ASPCA and taken the dog to a vet, you know. But he wasn't really getting that far with the licking, the nagging, the cutting, the splash, and all that. But the point is, he was overwhelmed with an empathetic feeling of the dog's condition. And that's why that was then universal compassion. He was like, he opened his mind from boundary himself off from the suffering of the other. And then therefore, because of the story, the Tibetans have a thing about dogs. It was a big story point with the Chinese invasion. The Chinese like to eat dogs, they breed them to eat. Like Chow Chow, as an ominous name, believe me. Like chow down. And that really upsets the Tibetans. But on the other hand, the Tibetan monasteries and monks adopt every kind of dog. But then they don't have vets and they don't really know how to take care of them. They just throw bones. And then the dogs become kind of feral and they have dog packs and it's a problem. Because they don't, but they love all the dogs, but they never would eat one. So anyway, that's the story.
That's a sangha there, actually.
Yes, and yes, in our chapel here, when we created the Tibet House, and His Holiness came, one thing His Holiness didn't like about our Tibet, he liked our Tibet House a lot. And we had an exhibit of Tibetan paintings and things when he did come. We had a luncheon here for some people with him. And he designed this chapel. After he was here, we put the Buddha here. We had a Tibetan come to make a consecrated Buddha. And he asked that we put a Sangha and Nagarjuna is the two statues there instead of other Buddhist angelic bodhisattvas like Maitreya and Manjushri, which they normally would put. So he wanted the human pundits there. So there's a statue of a Sangha on the right of the Buddha in that box there under the text. And these are the two of the 17 pundits of Nalanda. By pundit, he means the great scholar, saint, sages. You know, in ancient times, pundit didn't mean some guy at Fox News, like pundit. Pundit meant someone who was a great scholar, a great intellectual, great philosopher, but also a great practitioner, yogi, and really knew experientially what he or she was talking about, mostly Indian history. Then the women were not well reported in the patriarchal society, unfortunately. They were important women, but they were few and far between, unfortunately. Okay? So that's the story of that. Any questions? Do you want to say anything about that?
No, I was just thinking that this is, you know, that whole idea of the two of them being arrayed on each side, being the magnificent and the profound ways of approaching enlightenment.
Yeah, you want to explain that?
Well, as I understand it, there's two tendencies, you know, to the reconciling wisdom and compassion,
right,
and enlightenment.
Right.
One tendency is to start from an empathetic point of view,
right,
the Sangha tradition,
right,
working on compassion and discovering wisdom of emptiness,
right,
you know, out of compassion.
Right.
And the other side being the working at it from the point of view of an intellectual, let's just say, starting with an intellectual understanding of the non-difference of self and other.
Right.
Breakdown of that philosophical breakthrough.
Right. Right.
The emptiness and then the interconnectedness of self and other.
Right.
And developing compassion as a consequence, as a derivative of wisdom, as a
right,
wisdom as a derivative of compassion. Both of them ultimately being two sides of the same coin.
Right.
Which I always think is significant to mention is that there's a strong Western tendency to look at emotion and reason as being different in kind, you know, whereas I think the Buddhist thing is to look at them more as being different in degree or different aspects.
Mm-hmm.
So there's this idea that the you know, emotion or empathy, these types of things, compassion, is inherently irrational.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so it's Father Philo, Mother Sophia, it's love of wisdom, whereas in the Buddhist tradition, it's you know, wisdom and compassion,
mm-hmm,
twin truths, as opposed to the one subordinate to the other on a certain level. So I just think it's sometimes noteworthy to look, just to consider, because that was interesting to me, how it was that, you know, seeing through the appearances of things could actually make you more open to and empathetic with things and others,
mm-hmm,
like you're more open to and empathetic with them.
Mm-hmm.
And on the flip side, that caring for others could lead to reason, to greater understanding, that a greater closeness between things would lead to a much greater understanding.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I just thought that was an interesting, I always liked that interplay between the relative world of compassion and the sort of absolute world of independence,
mm-hmm,
as instances and statues.
I think that's really great that you brought that up. There are the two things that are called the two stages of the path. And the stages are what they call the right hand, in the Tibetan icons, you know, and this comes from India, but the Tibetans have elaborated. There's the what's called the magnificent deeds tradition, which comes from Maitreya and Asanga. And then on this side is the profound view, profound worldview tradition, and that comes from Manjushri and Narayana. So both sides are necessary. And it is true that compassion opens up you have to have a level of wisdom for compassion to open up. Because the wisdom is the wisdom of selflessness, right? It's where you begin to see through yourself. And the first level of it is where you see the impermanence of any particular feeling of constructive identity that you have. You see that you constantly change. And as soon as you see that, that opens up your connectedness to yourself and to others, and then you begin to feel their suffering, and then you can have true, but just feeling the suffering in itself is not necessarily compassion, because compassion is the unwillingness for them to have that suffering. So, in other words, if you're perceiving yourself as having a rigid identity, then you project someone who's suffering as their own, they're just going to suffer. So I'm sorry they're suffering, but there's nothing I can do about it. Evolve. But once you see your own impermanence, you realize everybody else is constantly changing. So then you realize, oh, they don't have to stay suffering. Because they can change. They can also get worse, but they can get better. So then that's when your suffering, your empathy turns into compassion, where you feel their suffering and want to do something about it. Do you know what I mean? It isn't like Bill Clinton, I feel your suffering, so I'm going to cancel welfare. As I know it. Like, I know that's mean. So I can't help it. So and then once you feel that, and you want to do something about it, you then realize, well, my wisdom of impermanence is not strong enough to really enable me to really do something to help them change. So then you want to deepen your wisdom with greater intensity because I need more wisdom to be able to help them. So then you come to the next level where you have the wisdom of personal selflessness, where you realize that your own personal identity is a construction. You don't have any part of yourself that is separate from things. Even your soul level is constantly interconnected as a person. And so when you realize that, then you have a stronger level of compassion. Because then you have a level of compassion where you see the person that you said the being, it doesn't have to be human, but the dog, you see it as a sort of impersonal process, and you see what's wrong with the process. You don't get caught up in their sense of their own personality, where I'm a suffering person, like, and I always will be. Because you realize your own self, the personal selflessness, which just means that your personality is itself also a construct. It's not only that it's impermanent, it's that it's purely interrelational. So therefore, you then see them more objectively like a process. And then the next final level, so then you more strongly have a stronger compassion with them. And then you realize you're still really not able to really deal with them as a process fully well because your wisdom is still not deep enough. So then you have more motive from your compassion to develop a stronger wisdom. And then you get what is called objective selflessness, the realization of it, which is emptiness. Which means, you know, the personal selflessness you could call subjective selflessness. The selflessness of yourself as a subjectivity. But then objective selflessness means that even their physical elements are selfless. So there's no condition of suffering as an impersonal process that is rigidly fixed there. Even that is totally interconnected, therefore, and totally empty of any intrinsic reality as a state of suffering, and therefore completely repairable, completely transformable. And then that's when you have like a Buddha level compassion there, where your compassion becomes skill and liberative art.
Do those relate to the three types of compassion?
That's exactly what I mean.
Right? No, but the three levels of compassion on the flip side, the compassion that sees objects,
compassion
that sees subjects, and then compassion that sees neither.
The compassion that sees person, the compassion that sees events, and the compassion that does not see anything.
Right.
The non-perceiving compassion. Those are the three levels.
But that's what I mean. In a sense,
I mean, that's just a label of it. In the sense that it sees through everything. That's the matrix compassion. The matrix compassion sees the suffering being, sees that the being is suffering, but that the being's well-being and suffering aspect is part of the programming of the matrix. And therefore sees right through the being. Oh, and actually sees right through the matrix. Anyway, can reshape the matrix to make them not suffer. You follow me? Which is what we were looking at, that sort of miraculous sign that we had in the Buddha, in the Buddha Matantika, you know, the Thurman and Ganden Thurman that we looked at last time. Right? Didn't we look at it? Yeah, we did look at that last time. Good. Thank you. That was very good. So then, now, the other thing that I think introductorily we have to touch on is, this is now what is called a Shastra. The word Shastra connects to the word Shastra in Sanskrit, which means a teacher. And it means that which teaches and repairs and amends or repairs. So a science, and it actually can translate science. A Shastra is a science. And the science teaches in the sense that it knows what is real. But science in the mind science and the Buddhist inner science, in the Indian actually, but the yogis have the same idea. In the Indic science thing, science is not just neutral, knowing reality as if reality is just a mechanism that's neutral. Science is knowing it in a way that benefits beings, knowing it in a beneficial way, learning about a reality with an attempt to discover what is a benefit and what is a harm within the reality. So then, Shastra, the way they etymologize the word Shastra, the tra part is connected to Tara, the goddess, the liberatrix, freedom, to liberate Tara. And so it it's a teaching which liberates. So this is the Dalai's big quest, actually, really, truly speaking, you know, in his mind and life. His whole thing is, he wants to do ethics. He wants the scientists to do ethics. And he noted that our scientists think that they are beyond ethics. Right? Oh, an A-bomb? Oh, you can make an A-bomb? Well, maybe it's not a good idea to put A-bombs in the hands of lunatic leaders. But by sharing the knowledge of how atoms can be efficient and be split. But, you know, once we know that it can be done, we have to do it because we can, and we don't have to make an ethical choice here. Because we just discovered reality without any ethical concern, right? And but they did actually, Einstein and these guys did, and Lord Brown, they all escaped from Germany, not because they did their habit. They decided to let Harry Truman. I'm Taylor from Missouri. Well, I think they wanted Roosevelt. He died. Eleanor would have not used it, I'm sure. Some ladies in kimonos. Eleanor would have been against that. But unfortunately, Truman was Truman. So, the point is that it has built into it, our science, it has an ethical thing built in. And I remember, I won't digress into it. So therefore, the great pundits who were these successors of the Buddha, really, they were enlightened Buddhas in a way themselves. Sangha, Narayana, many of them. There's like a set of 17 that His Holiness wrote special prayers for, but there were 700 of them in the library that we have. And but there were 17 sort of outstanding ones over 1,000 years in the Buddhist university. And as I said before in our earlier classes, Buddhism is really an educational system. So the great leaders of the Buddhist tradition were doing education. And what we call a monastery, the viharas, were the dorms for the students. And the idea that, you know, the idea of they weren't monks. They were students in the dorms, and they were mendicants. So the Buddha was a smart university founder. You don't go to the kings and the mayors and the merchants and say, we need big donations. We need $100 million to build a university here and then some people can come get here. No. You just have some people who go there with a bowl and they say, give me lunch. And then, if you like, I'll give you a lecture for the lunch. If you don't, I won't. But I'm going to be back for lunch tomorrow or some one of my colleagues. I can't give advice to the same hour. And I can have lunch. And you can't give me lunch for 3 days, because I can only sit for today. Someone else will come for another one tomorrow. And that's so that each time somebody gets a lunch, they a free lunch, they get to give you a free lecture. And so many people wanted to learn and attain freedom and enlightenment that there were a lot of people looking for free lunch. And India was the richest country in Eurasia in those days. Right up until Columbus, pretty much. That's why Columbus was headed for India, remember? That's why they called Indians here. You know that? They weren't called Indians because he was going to get rice and dal in Mexico. He didn't call Indians because he thought he was in India. Because that's where he wanted to go. Because that was everybody knew in Europe that was the rich place. So, you know, richer than Europe. So, not richer. So that was a way of founding a university. Students are all on scholarship. And the faculty, all they get is a free lunch. Because they remain mendicants. And faculty, you know, teachers are still learners. You know, if you're a good teacher, you have to always keep learning. And you can, we've been through that, but any teacher who thinks they know everything is not a good teacher. That's the fact. Luckily, I'm too stupid to think that. So, or not stupid enough to think that. So I was learning something. Like I read my own writing here, I was delighted. What you said. I'm delighted I said a few things that were useful, which I've forgotten in between. But I made something that nobody else has picked up on, actually. You know, because one thing is that in the hierarchy of philosophical views, the Sangha Maitreya tradition is considered less accurate, if you will, than the Manjushri Nagarjuna tradition, what I would call centrism versus idealism. You know, the idealism is the Maitreya Sangha one is more like everything's in the mind, you know. The world is created by an interconnected mind field, like Buddha said in the Vimalakirti, you know. So actually, everything is mental, is what they say. These things that seem to be external objects are not, they're really in your mind. But since we have many minds, it's not a solipsism because we have many minds. So we both see him, so it's lucky for him, he exists. But not only us, a lot million other beings see him, and various micro beings and deities and angels and demons. And so in other words, our interwoven mind fields are what actually creates the world. And so the real nature, it's like saying the matrix is basically a mental interweaving of many, many subjectivities. You follow me? And that is considered, then the Madhyamaka, the centrist view of emptiness, and they have a view of emptiness, and they think they're centrist, actually, the idealists. They argue their view as if it was the high view. And for someone like that, it is a high view. But the centrists criticize them, and they say, you're mistaking something. In a way, yes, it's all mental, but the way mind structures things is through language. And therefore, also, it's better to consider other beings as external to you. Even though on some ultimate level, it's all one mind, it's all Buddha mind, maybe it's Buddha mind with a body, or it's all one body. But on some level, it's more conventionally practical to consider things as external to you. So it's sort of very subtle. It isn't canceling the idealism, philosophical idealism. It's moving it into a more relativistic, conventionalistic level. And you know, I'm not expecting to go a little more into this another time. But I'm saying they're considered to be kind of hierarchy. However, you know, when I wrote this here, I was very pleased. I said, historically, it seems that the Sangha of Vasubandhu, that was his brother, who was also a commentator on this Maitreya work, although the Sangha was the one who went to heaven in Maitreya, over a sizable expansion of the Buddhist movement in Gupta dominated India of the 5th and 6th centuries of the Common Era. The idealistic interpretation of the universal vehicle that they so powerfully advanced has long been looked at as mainly a philosophical or ideological doctrine, expounding primarily an intellectual worldview. You know, it's all in your mind, mind only thing. And it was very big in China. The Chinese Buddhism is pretty much only idealistic. Their Madhyamaka, their relativism things, kind of weak, as the mostly in all Chinese Buddhism. Its religious dimension has not been well elucidated. A clue can be taken from the Tibetan tradition in which the hierarchy of series is arranged in such a way that the idealistic, or what I like to call experientialist theory, represents the philosophical entry point of the universal vehicle. So in other words, a person who is into dualistic Buddhism, it's most in a way convenient for them to enter the bodhisattva mind under the philosophical or reality view that reality is all mental. You get it? Some Tibetan, I'll skip that. Although I have not yet skipped this too. Okay. My hunch is that this is connected to the spiritual decisions involved in the Bodhisattva vow, the central undertaking of the Bodhisattva that marks the beginning of the Mahayana path, wherein she or he takes the formal vow to liberate every single being without exception from suffering and to lead them all into the bliss of Buddhahood, turning the entire universe into a Buddhaverse. In other words, it's a pretty daunting thing, if you think about it, to decide, okay, I am going to take upon myself the sufferings of all beings, and I'm going to become a Buddha, which I understand, I hope is true, is the way of being which can actually do that. This is like the Christian mystical tradition in England called Imitatio Christi, the imitation of Christ. Whereas rather than what is currently done at the Rotary Club in Topeka, which is, I'm going to sin all week, and then Christ will save me on Sunday, and when I die, by repenting of all my sins. Because he's dying to save us, right? Although we are sinners. You follow me? Instead of that, we are taking on the suffering of these and we're redeeming all of them. But everybody comes to pick up the messianic attitude, if you follow me, which is crazy. And I'm going to talk about it later in the later chapter here. But, you know, you can't do that even if you're a materialist. I always, you know, that sometimes when the Dalai Lama teaches, I'm chosen, among others, to, but basically they like to teach, have me teach about this bodhisattva vow business. But in the Tibetan tradition, everybody takes the bodhisattva vow, without ceremony, that bodhisattva vow, no problem. But meanwhile, for someone to try to take bodhisattva vow, who is ideologically materialist, meaning there's no former future life, it's their common sense feeling, is insane. How are you going to save all beings in the next, in my case, maybe 10 to 15 years? Maximum health by keep eating more health food and exercise. In younger people, maybe 20, 30 years, how are they going to save old beings from suffering? It's ridiculous. I've been in Zen centers where they have a thing, they do it for ceremony, they say, sentient beings are numberless, I vow to save them all. And I ask them, are you going to have a future life? Oh, heck no, that's a primitive ancient thing, we don't need that. We're modern Zenies. Well, excuse me, you vowed to save numberless beings. How are you going to have, how many minutes? How many a second? How are you going to get that all done in the next even 100 years? And therefore, this vow that you're taking is what kind of promise? You don't believe you can fulfill it when you take it. That's not taking a vow. So therefore, I always tell, I give a picture about, don't take it unless you critically examine the authority and the evidence of those who assure you that you will not have a future existence. Your continuum, not you and your personality, you know, with your name and everything, but your soul continuum, your subtle body mind, you know, like your dream body mind. How can, until you critically examine their authority, because they have zero authority, and they just assert it in order to escape from their own fear of the future life, the negative possible future, right? Their own fear of hell, fear of animal life, fear of being Galapagos turtle. You know, some British gentleman was referred to being a Galapagos turtle, inspected and examined by another British gentleman, or eaten by a Chinese gentleman in turtle soup. They don't want that. And then they have every reason not to. So the best way out of that is we assert we'll have no future life, so we don't have to worry. But that's all that there is, no evidence for that. And there's a lot of evidence on the other side. But still, it's a matter of investigating. So I always do the thing, don't take the bodhisattva vow. The Tibetans actually have a good system. And they say, if you like the sound of the bodhisattva vow, I'm going to save all beings myself. Then there is a way, there's a ceremony where you can take a vow to be able to take the vow.
Which one? I mean, doesn't it go back to the Sangha who has the empathy but not the skill of the written means?
You know? Maybe, so yeah.
The Zen guy,
maybe the
on the positive side, it's the cultivation of an empathy.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And the flip side, maybe it's getting stuck in the empathy if you have that additional added view of it. I suppose it depends on how you cultivate and develop the wisdom side, you know, from the inspiration.
But see, the wisdom side, in order to really sincerely take a bodhisattva vow, it has to be credible to you yourself. In order to be credible to you yourself, and you can do something for all beings, you have to be in a situation where you feel, at least intellectually, infinitely interconnected with all sentient beings. Like you can't get away from that. You know, like here we are, I'm talking to you, he's done is talking to you, we're talking to each other, you know. If we ever shut up, you can ask a question. So we can talk to us. But then we go our separate ways. Then the course is over, then we never see each other, maybe sometimes. And we relate to people. I always have, you know, my thing about the subway, because that's a very good business in New York. But if you ride the subway, you know that you get on the subway, you trip by yourself. You have to have a book with you. You read the book, or else you're stuck with looking at Baron Bloomberg's advertisements. But you're going to be reading something, because one thing you really don't want to do is look at anybody else in the subway. And if they start looking at you, you get uptight. And you don't want to look at them. If they start looking at you, then when you get off, you want to make sure they're not following you. So our relationship with each other in the subway is very superficial. We don't want to have involvement with other people, particularly. Occasionally, maybe we're in a certain mood and somebody, you know, wearing the same jacket we are, we might affect up a conversation or they're reading a book that we know, or whatever. But mostly we avoid them. And we get off and we're never going to see them again inside here. We never have seen them before, we're never going to see them again. Right? The thought experiment is, you're on your subway, Lexington Avenue line, going down to Union Square, and suddenly your car is shunted off like a James Bond sort of thing, your side channel, and the windows come slamming down, and a voice sounding like Henry Kissinger says, "This is an experiment of national security. You will not escape from here, ever. He will provide food, there's a bathroom over there. Please don't tell me your uncle is like the president. You will not get out of here. No way will you ever get out, and your relatives will be told that you were taking away a national security experiment and then took off like Homeland Security, like, good luck." And then people are like, "You know who I am? Pounding the door, you can't get out," and shattered the glass. After a while, you come to an acceptance, you're here with these people. Then how do you start looking at the people on the subway? Of course, you, even an ordinary person, you're going to look to see who's like-minded, who looks freaked out, who looks sick, who looks healthy, who might be friends, who's going to be a problem. If anybody has a freak out, everybody tries to calm them down because they're in the same space. So we're all concerned with their freak out. Your whole attitude to everybody in the car has to change, right? Once you have credibility, you're stuck with that, right? So the worldview of infinite interconnectedness is a worldview that we're all reborn. We have been from the beginning of this time reborn with each other. We've been each other's mothers, you know, kind of thing. And in the future, we'll continue to be reborn. And heaven forbid we should have to be each other's mothers again. Right? You don't want to be my mom again. I'm talking to a guy here. He doesn't. You want to be female? You have to, like, gestate me. I'm going to be a brat. You don't want me to be your mom. Right? Again, I don't want to be your mom again. But we don't understand that. We joke about how grateful we are to other beings for having been our moms many, many beginning of lifetimes. And we want to be the great mom to all of them, which is the transcendent wisdom mother that helps them find their freedom and their happiness and not to suffer. The Buddha thing. So in other words, this empathy thing you're saying, he felt, because he pushed the wisdom to a certain point, he had no, the wisdom was critical of any arbitrary definition of self that was disconnected from that dog and suffering of that dog. And he received the dog and even the maggot as having his mother described. Now that maggot had really gone down into a lower life form. But he was feeling that connected to every piece of life. So then he's compelled to try to do something about it. But the one thing he didn't have, of course, yet, was skill in liberating art, the art of liberating beings, because he was like wasting delay and he was like running town. So then Maitreya had to dictate 5 books to them. Okay? You get it? So these shastras then are considered like these are the curricular books of the curriculum. You see, the Dalai Lama runs around, everybody loves Dalai Lama. But have you ever been to a Dalai Lama teaching here in New York at a vegan dinner or somewhere? Have you ever been to one? Right? Well, when he gets enjoying. Well, this table is not a table, and it's not his legs, and it's not this, and it's not the atoms, and it's time, and the other says it's in mind, and somebody else says it. And are you zoning out at that point? As he's translating by the other guy, you sure are. And my wife gets very frustrated because people are falling asleep here. They're like, it's just a relation with the matrix. Then they wake up and don't worry, go, "That was wonderful. I'm going to help. Fantastic. What a blessing." They go to you afterwards. "Oh, it's one of the things that was so great. What was it?" And then one day I go to his one and say, "Honest, could you talk about compassion? You know, talk about something simple." He says, "Yeah, I was doing that." And because His Holiness wants us to learn. But then His Holiness always says, "I'm the son of Nalanda. I'm not a follower of this sect of Buddhism in Tibet, that sect. I don't wear this kind of hat, that kind of hat. I am the son of the lineage of the great pandas of Nalanda." And they're like, "What is he talking about?" But what he's talking about is the curriculum that he studied is this book and 3,988 other books, which he asked me to translate all of them. Thanks a lot. I've done one. And you like five or ten. Now we've done a few. We have a team, but we're far from getting done because the world doesn't consider it a priority. The world thinks this is some old-fashioned museum thing that some weird Buddhist did thousands of years ago, and that the neuroscientists are going to solve all the problems.
That's what I was saying before. I think it's interesting about that divide, the connection between ethics and understanding that knowledge isn't power, that knowledge is liberated rather than empowered.
Yeah.
Which is an interesting idea because it's adding that ethical element in there. Power is neutral. Liberating the intent, the sociological intent to liberate another or oneself, you know, it implies that requires that ethical input.
Mm-hmm.
You know, whereas our whole intellectual tradition completely divides us these hard and soft sciences. You know, one soft science economics, but other than that, it's all they're all a piece of the pot, and neither gets you any good. So, like in America, you have this funny thing. You notice that we're having a lot of these problems because you can either be religious, or you can be worldly. But you cannot be both.
Right.
And in fact, you have to be engaged on one side or another of the culture war.
Right.
And I think it's symptomatic
of
this sort of arbitrary division, the idea that knowledge will actually work and twist you into Dr. Frankenstein on one level. Sensitivity, this type of thing, will make you completely ineffectual. But the idea, it's really radical, the idea that the two are productive of the other. You know, I mean, even our greatest scientists, of course, did have that spiritual bent, even if they had later Einstein and so forth. I mean, they had that ethical spiritual. Because they developed the knowledge side so much. I mean, the actual scientists themselves, I think, do have that outpouring of understanding to empathy. As a practical matter, just because it happens.
Right.
But I think the general consensus is that this type of idea is already inherently flawed. You know, religion is flawed because of all the intent.
Well, even the Buddhist
religion can't be real because it has an intent involved in it. It has a certain
My life's ambition as an academic was and remains to teach Nagarjuna some about these people in philosophy. I don't know why I'm in a religious sense so much. I mean, I do. Because of the prejudice. But I shouldn't be in a religious science department because I make religious people nervous. I do. When I was at Amherst College, I was surprised. There was one guy, Kevin something. He was a fundamentalist family from Arkansas. And he was a religion major. And he had to come to certain courses were required. He had to come to Asian Religion Survey course. Otherwise, he majored in Christian studies and he didn't really have to. He was an undergraduate major. He didn't have to come to my classes, but he didn't have to come to that one. So when he did his senior project, at that time the senior projects were of the majors were to do a journal chronicling their studies. And he didn't have time in his senior year. He said that every single class of mine he went to, and I wasn't dealing with Christianity, but every single class of mine he went afterwards to the chapel to pray to be saved from the danger of mental clarity. Really? I'm getting up around here to meet people and then I'm not having my faith and I think it makes sense and all these kinds of things. Well, I didn't apply it to Christianity. I felt a little better when he said that when he went to the Christian studies guy who was talking about how the New Testament was written in Alexandria, the book of John, the Apostle John, never met Jesus. He wrote it in 110 of the Common Era in Alexandria, a period of time when there was a big conflict between the new Jewish Christians and the rabbinic Jews. And they were quite hostile and they had riots and fought with each other. So then the anti-Semitic strain that's in the Gospel of John came from that era in Egypt. But he learned things like that. In other words, it didn't come straight from Jesus' mouth to John, you know, because John never met him. Neither did Matthew end up. You know, the biblical scholarship knows that. They studied that. But he also went and prayed after that, probably harder. you know. You know, there's a famous story about the Dharmacharya. So looking at the text itself, the prologue is quite marvelous. And the footnotes are here, I think in the handout you have the beginning. And this shows that, like in the time of Asanga, actually, like Augustine, I make a parallel to Augustine, the father. Augustine tried to take, you know, Christianity was beginning to become mainstream in his time, in the Roman Hellenic world. So Augustine was trying to make, you know, he wrote City of God, all this kind of thing, and he was trying to make an interconnection, actually, in favor of Christianity, of course, but still, he was trying to make it, you know, legible to people who were steeped in Greek and Roman classics. I mean, he was interconnecting it, and he was putting it down a bit to make Christianity the one religion. But still, he was reframing things in terms, that's why he's had a huge impact, because he was reframing things in terms of the Greco-Roman thing, in his own particular way. The Orthodox people had their own version of that, luckily, because, and I won't get into that, but I had my colleague and I, we discussed it. And Mark, Father Mark. So Asanga is doing the same thing in connection to a resurgent Hindu culture, because actually Hinduism is just being formed in this time. Currently, Hindus think they were formed at the time of the Vedas, but that's wrong. Because Hinduism is half Vedic and half Buddhist, which they, you know, the Vedas are about vegetarian. I mean, that's a wrong story, I'm not going to get into it historically. But the point is, so he is formulating Buddhism in this way. In a big urban setting now, not so rural, and merchant families are supporting the big universities and royal and merchant families. And it's the right, that's why I translated Alankara, which means ornament, literally, as literature, because we understand literature as ornamented words, you know, ornamented language, language that is ornamented. You know, need to make it more acceptable to people, that it has a certain beauty, it's attractive. So, you know, belles lettres, the French concept of belles lettres, you know, beautiful letters, you know, literature. So, and I did something quite heretical. I insist that this prologue is not written by Maitreya. In other words, this is a Sangha preface, which has got lost in the tradition, but said, but it can't be because he praises Maitreya in a way that Maitreya wouldn't say, most likely. So, our Lord Maitreya, knowing the supreme import of the universal beautiful scriptures, creates an exhibition of that import with flawless language and expressions in order to save beings from suffering, he being compassion incarnate. To those beings who seek the Dharma, the truth as taught in the supreme vehicle, he reveals his fivefold interpretation and elegant way to the unexcelled. So, I mean, and there's this verse is so pregnant and keen, but you can read the footnotes yourself. I'm not gonna do that. Would you, do you want to ask some question, any question, Prof?
I'm good for
you. You're good. Okay. All right. So the point is that there's something very interesting about it. For example, usually in a light being is called, you know, like Sarvajnana, knower of everything, or Dharmanyo, knower of Dharma. But he calls it here Artanyo, knower of meaning or import. And this word Arta is a very important word in Sanskrit, that it can mean meaning, import, it can also mean value, it can also mean wealth. You know, it's a merchant word. It has like a, it's a very urbane kind of thing, knowing, it's like knowing the weight of things, the meaning of things, the value of them. You know, Artha has all those meanings. Like Buddha's, it can mean a goal also. Like when Shakyamuni Buddha was born as a young prince, his name was Siddhartha, which means one who has achieved his goal, or who will achieve his goal, Siddhartha, who has achieved meaningfulness. Because achieving meaningfulness is to live in such a way that you have evolved into a higher type of being by the time you die than when you were born. That's a meaningful way to live. If you realize that your life is an evolution, part of an evolutionary process, and as a human being, you can consciously shape your evolutionary trajectory in your human life, and then if you don't consciously do it, it will be unconsciously shaped by your culture, then meaningfully it is to choose how you shape your life. Because you want to be more aware You want to be more mindful, you want to be more loving, you want to be more open, you want to be more beautiful, you want to be more amazing by the time you die. You don't want to be a grumpy old man. Except they're cute in that movie, yeah, right? But you don't want to just be a grumpy old man or woman. And when your life flashes before your eyes, you don't want it to be like uninteresting. What did I do? Oh, I worked at the office. Okay. The Dharma here, just look, that wonderful Elizabeth Kubler-Ross, she said that she's by the end of her career, she was the one who started the hospice movement and was into the dying thing. One of them, she said, she had been with 10,000 people when they died, helped them die. She'd been in that process with 10,000 people. I believe it, she said. And not a single one of those 10,000 people told her, looked up at her and said, Elizabeth, I really wish I'd spent more time at the office. The Dharma here disclosed. So this Dharma, some people always have the Dharma as religion, even. But it can have that meaning. Vasubandhu, actually the writer of commentary here, has given a thing where he said there in the fifth century, there are 11 major meanings of the word Dharma. And the first five or six of them are what are called pattern-maintaining meanings, to use a phrase of a famous sociologist who was my teacher at Harvard, Talcott Parsons, very well known as well. Pattern-maintaining meaning, because it comes from dhir, the root to hold, so therefore dharma means law in Sanskrit, like which holds behavior in a certain pattern of control, right? And dharma can mean custom, it can mean duty, it can actually mean a phenomenon which is held like a glass, is held by its definition as something that holds fluid, holds water. So it's in that sense, it's a phenomenon of glass fitting its definition, so it holds its definition, it holds water. But then, the upper meanings of karma introduced by Buddha especially are what are called pattern transcending meanings. And Buddha says, you know, what is being held here are beings who are part of reality. And real reality holds them in freedom from suffering. That's what the Dharma is. Truth makes you free. In that sense, Dharma holds you in freedom. So it holds you apart from being held rigidly in some structure where you inevitably suffer. So these are pattern transcending, these are freedom meaning, right? And all the teaching is like that. Why is teaching like that? Teaching means that because when you learn a teaching, you're free, you get greater power, you get greater knowledge, you get greater freedom. When you learn, right, you have more tools to use to move around in a more beneficial way. Dharma can mean beneficial practice, virtue. Dharma can mean truth, in the sense of real reality, and nirvana, actually. The highest meaning of dharma is nirvana. Because the non-dual view of this text and this curriculum is that nirvana holds us in freedom right now. Our only problem is we don't know that. So we are resisting being held in freedom, and we're fighting to keep fighting, and struggling against what we conceive to be an overwhelming, dangerous universe that is going to do us in if we don't fight. Right, that's what we think. Therefore he's saying, the Dharma here disclosed gives the utmost joy, like gold hand beaten, like a lotus fully bloomed, like a delicious feast when famished, like good news read in a letter, or like a casket of jewels thrown open. You open a jewel, you know, like treasure hunter finds casket of jewels, and they do it, and then they connect this to the commentators, in this case a Tibetan one, and he doesn't quite go into that. But yeah, Vasubandhu, he says, how manifold, before that, in introducing this verse on page 3 also, he says, how manifold is this ornament he creates, it is fivefold. He reveals an interpretation which is elegant, conducive to the unexcelled transcendent wisdom. and of a fivefold nature, and then I put in brackets from the Tibet, and the rest from the Tibet, right? I.e., provable, understandable, conceivable, inconceivable, and perfect. These are five levels of meaning. And so each of these similes goes to a particular layer of that meaning. So gold hand beaten is like something with provable meaning that just makes good sense, you know, it's common sense. And something like a hand beaten piece of gold, it means you joy. When you see a beautiful piece of, you know, pre-Columbian hand beaten gold or even a ring, or something, it gives you pleasure, you know, you see it. And that's like a provable meaning. Then a lotus fully bloomed is fully understandable. It's like it's given its bloom to you, blooms in mind. A delicious feast when famished, that is conceivable. You can conceive being satisfied. And when you're hungry, particularly, it's very good. And now that's one. Good news read in a letter is inconceivable, meaning it's surprising. It's amazing. You know, you didn't expect that. Usually we get bad news in everything we meet. Suddenly there's a good news. Oh, I want them. That's inconceivable. I do like them. Fits with my pessimistic outlook, of my Presbyterian nature. It's like, well, we're going to go wrong, like a Scotch thing. And inconceivable. And then finally, perfect is the casket of jewels from him. That's perfection. But look, he's talking, these similes are all appealed to educated, urbane, yuppie, merchant-type level people in the urbanizing, very wealthy Indian economy of this time, where even kings, city-state kings, have to borrow, and the Gupta emperors have to borrow for their campaigns and their self-defense from the merchant class who have accumulated the wealth, and who really like the evolutionary life teaching of Buddhism because they're self-made. And they don't like the inherited aristocratic thing that some total dorky guy who's a prince, a spoiled brat, lived in a harem, can like boss them around and confiscate their wealth with taxes and behave like a brat. Like we've known some, we even in America, we had a brat recently in charge. It was disastrous, right? And I won't say, nobody knows who I'm for. It's a nice brat, but he is a real brat. Just as a well-adorned feast of naturally outstanding beauty gives people even more intense delight than they behold it in a mirror. So this, that's an interesting one. It's like somebody who's already beautiful, but then they look themselves in the mirror and then they get a right angle and they look even better. They don't have photography at the time. Right? It's like fashion. So this Dhamma, which is always outstanding in its natural brilliance, gives a still more distinct satisfaction to the wise when its meaning is critically elucidated. So it sort of brings out.
Well, if you know something well enough to utilize it, obviously that's...
Right. If you what?
If you know something well enough to use it,
yes.
To benefit from it, I mean, you can recite, you can memorize things, but to be able to apply with that knowledge, either verbally or in your actions or
right.
And so forth. This is obscure.
I think it's true. And but he's saying some of them are really beautiful and they like to look at themselves in the mirror. Ugly one better not, you know, that crazy look away. But you know, I had a son-in-law once. I won't mention name again, but in a house where there are mirrors in a house, and this is an actor mirror, so actors can be like that, where they're talking to you, but then they might see a mirror, and then they start talking to themselves. Very takes you aback when you walk. And then, you know, you want to restrain yourself, a shouting narcissist. It's like a medicine foul in smell, and sweet in taste. This dharma should be understood. You have two dimensions. Its literal dimensions, and the always beneficial dimension of its import. Its deeper meaning. This dharma is expansive, tough and deep, is like a monarch, very hard to please, and yet also like a monarch, once pleases the bestower of the treasure of the highest excellence. And finally, just as the priceless classic jewel gives no satisfaction to the undiscriminating person, this dharma is wasted on the unintelligent. In the opposite cases, each gives due satisfaction in the same way. So that's the prologue. And then we have chapter 4, I wanted to speak something about the 27 mind. Let me see. Yeah, we have all the time. Do you have any questions on this whole thing of Shastra? You know, the sutras that we looked at in the Tibetan system and in the system of India and Nalanda, people did not really read them because they considered that they were discourses given by Buddha to some especially lucky people who met Buddha. So although they are the sort of background, they feel that the, what happened?
Just give me a minute.
They feel that the ordinary people in later eras can't necessarily get things from them. So they instead, they mostly use for their own study and practice the Shastras, these later books, that are organizing things into a path, you know, that the people can use. So they organize the different things Buddha taught specifically to different persons in specific context, and creating a curriculum that everyone can use. You know, although within that curriculum, there are certain things that will appeal especially to certain people. You follow? So, for example, when I translated, was commissioned to translate the Vimalakirti Sutra when I was fresh out of graduate school, I really hadn't read it. Particularly, I'd seen some quotes in this kind of Shastra, but I had been reading these path texts, you know, that the Tibetans use. And then on holidays, they'll just read the sutra for blessings. I mean, they don't feel that it gives you the systematic method that they have developed for later types of people. Right? In China, and Japan, and Korea, on the other hand, they make a big thing out of the sutras themselves, but they still do read commentaries by Chinese pundits and Korean pundits, like Won Hyo, like the great Won Hyo and others. And so they still do follow the teachings readapted to their era by their own teachers. And then even they think maybe the sutra, but they sort of worship the sutra, but they even think you can't understand the sutra. They in a way agree. But they, unfortunately, for them, they only have a small percentage of this library of Nalanda. Because from the time of Shamsan, very few people went to India and brought new books. Very, very few. Because there was no patronage for that. And it was too hard to travel. So they, the latter 300 or 400 years of the most amazing works they missed, and completely missed the tantras. And they think the tantras are some weird, like, sex orgy, corruption, and could possibly put it maybe the Tibetans and men all them, which is totally false. They were completely existing in India. And the most refined inner science, they're like psychoneurology of meditation. It's unbelievably amazing. But that has not still been introduced to the non-Tibetan Buddhist world. They don't know. Even great scholars in Japan who knew the Tibetan language, I used to debate with them, discuss it. And they all freak out because you know, they see the male, female Buddhas, you know, like the erotic ones, or the ferocious, fierce ones, and they think, oh no, demons and like sex and violence. Oh, no. And they didn't read Freud, you know, and everybody's unconscious has it in, you know, with Eros and Thanatos in it. So tantras are a much earlier discovery of Eros and Thanatos, and they're not at all an indulgence of Eros and Thanatos. They are the learning to handle like fire and flame, you know, much better than Freud did, actually. Because those great adepts, they didn't smoke cigars and sniff cocaine like Freud did and write books. But he wrote good books, right? He was constantly sniffing cocaine. It was a big cocaine. It was. It was legal. Okay. Where did Ganden go? So any questions about this Shastra, Sutra, any of these things we discussed? Then we're going to go into Bodhisattva mind. Now, one thing I want to ask while I'm pausing here. Did you all contribute to an email list? No? Maybe, I don't know, Tom, can you get a pad of paper somewhere? The reason I'm saying this is that for next week, we could just read more in here. And as I said, any of you can download it. You just put the title of the book. I want to make a note of it. Don't you? Take the title of this book if you're around. I'm not saying you have to find the book. You take the title out, put it in Google. It will immediately put you. you at the top three hits in Google. One of them will be a Russian website, RU. And on that Russian website, you can get a PDF that you can download for free. And the fine with me, Dharma should be free anyway, right? Except you have to give lunch in exchange. And so I'm asking them to bring a pad because we still don't have this email list. So I want an email list because what one book I do want to read is a Narayana book called The Jewel Rosary, or sometimes they translate it Jewel Garland, which I don't like. But, you know, I forgot how we are, but it's the title. And what it is Narayana, the other guy, the profound guy, one of the two great founders, they were the two great pioneers, Narayana and the Sangha. And it has its advice to a king by Narayana. So it has the very profound teachings of Narayana. Did you find one now? Yeah, great. So just give it in the back and start going. And anybody who wants the announcement of the reading of next week, which will only be a few pages, I will email it to everybody on that list. I've been frustrated that I can't communicate with the group because the reading sources are kind of, I've been endeavoring too much for it. But I'm just giving you little tastes of things to whet your insight and interest. And then each one of them is a huge panorama for you, but then you can either choose to enter or not. And anyway, I want to do this now because he has wonderful things in there, this advice to the king, that I really like. He has a thing, like, one thing I really like. He says, I want you to endow colleges. And of course, he had in mind these monastic colleges and universities, but the faculty, a lot of them are monastic. Because they want the faculty monastic because then they're cheap salary. They don't have tuition payment for their children. They don't have children. So they live on free lunches. So I never give that statement in front of any university administrator. They'll immediately cut their salary. In fact, downsize it. But he says, and then in those colleges there should be historians. And the ones you want to have in there, in these colleges, are people who will study the history of their region to such an extent that the neighboring kings' hairs will stand up on end for fear of having a bad reputation. Because these historians will find out all the nasty things they did and write about, and their legacy will be bad. And so the only kind of historian to give tenure to, in other words, that Nagarjuna said this in the 3rd century before the Common, after the Common Era. He says the only endowed teachers who will terrify the rulers.
Controlling the social media.
What?
Social media,
like they didn't have internet, unfortunately, at the time. But I'm sure he would really want to count on that. And then he has great stuff like, he says, like, don't have a big harem. You know, you can only have one wife at a time. Like, you don't need a big harem, it'll be a big waste. You have to build each one a palace and bankrupt your country, and people will be mad. Don't build too many big palaces, you only get one room at a time. By 800 rooms. It things like that are in there. And then, like, don't get them all caught up in lust. If you think the body is clean, just take a look at yourself. That's how when you go to the bathroom, then you'll be a little less attracted to everything. He really gives that king to the motto. And then he has a lot of practical things. Plant trees on all the roads. Have free Howard Johnsons at every stop. Have a special person who goes out in nature and puts grain and honey and things at anthills. So the ants will have food. It's like ecological. And abolish capital punishment in the 2nd century of the Common Era. Never think you're going to execute even a murderer. The worst person who you can't control, you banish them. But never kill. Never kill anybody. Any prisoner is like your own son. You're trying to rehabilitate. You know, a wayward son, you're trying to rehabilitate. He's going on like that. 2nd century BC, CE. It's extraordinary. I don't want you to read that. And I have a translation, Joe Lixo did one. It is better than, there's a published one called Precious Garland. But there's a better one that I'm going to send to everybody who's on this list. Is that moving along that path? You're moving it? Okay. this email. I don't even need to know anybody's name, just an email. I will make an email like that. And, okay. So, any comment on the Shastra thing you want to say? But the difference between reading sutras and the discourse when you have discourse of the Buddha to specific context. The Buddha was always speaking in specific context to someone. As opposed to the curricularly organized works of the Shastra, which I said the Tibetan folks study, you know, and even the Chinese, and even the East Asian people.
Well, only that it seems logical to me that the literature would reflect the basic principle, which is that there's multiple perspectives on this subject
right.
reality. So presumably that should be instanced in multiple experts in it. Mm-hmm. It's something that's attainable. Mm-hmm. Then presumably that attainability should be demonstrable
right.
by having a literature that's replete rather than relying as a
right.
place, what it suggests you don't do on the authority of your being, you know, deontologically on the authority of
right.
the original speaker.
Right.
So
it's not really literalistic.
So it's just
all of it is distorted. Including the Pali that they have in Sri Lanka that they think is the original Buddhism, which is not correct from our point of view. It's controversial. But none of them, including them, were written down for centuries. They didn't write them down. And then people think, oh, and that's just nothing. That's like 15-hand reportage in written scripture. But in a way, it isn't in India, because in India, they have these traditions, which the Vedas are also preserved, that spiritual things should never be written. As merchants do writing, and spiritual people, sages and things, memorize things. And they have these amazing memories, and they have all kind of metric systems, and rhymes, and metrics, and meters, and rhythms that enable them to do that. The Vedas are never written down. And yet they're preserved, they're preserved even today, they don't like them written down. They sort of authoritatively, scholars, they don't. Because they're verbal, they're oral. And they had a thing in the early Buddhist monasteries where when someone had memorized a particular sutra, maybe 500 pages, when they were growing older, there were four, five disciples who would they would transmit that memorization to, and they were
schools.
And they were all very good at memorizing because it was part of their education. Unlike us, we can't remember anything because we haven't anything in Google, I remember being deteriorating. Like when I was a kid in school, I had to memorize Shakespeare plays and things like that. And you memorize long poems, it was a tradition that you did. As older people, the younger people never understand that problem. Right? Even multiplication table. You have slide rules and like press a button on your Samsung notes, 3, and it gives you the answer. So you don't have to memorize those things. But your brain can do that. Okay, well, then now we come to chapter 3 or 4. So I've already talked about the spirit of enlightenment. So he gives a thing. The Bodhisattva's conception of the spirit is a will, and people, by the way, this word, the word is literally bodhicitta. And people insist on writing it B-O-D-H-I, that's okay, bodhi, and then C-I-T-T-A. So people in English, you read that in English, they go bodhicitta. Nobody knows that's a cha. And they get annoyed with me, these people in Sanskrit transcription, when I write ch. Because that's what it is, it's bodhicitta. And chit can be used for mind or spirit. Chitta, the word chit. And chit means to compile actually something. As a verb, to compile something. So chitta, the mind, is a compiler, and the spirit is a compiler too, in the sense of the subtle mind, of the soul mind, it compiles the residue of your actions of body, speech, and mind in life into what they call a spiritual gene. The previous chapter says, but it's too complicated, I didn't want you to read that. But then they call the spiritual gene, which is a word gutra, which relates to, just like the word gene does, relates to the word gens, which means tribe, like clan, or tribe, gens. So gene is that which, like, you know, continues the clan, I think, in a materialist cultural sense. So that's where we get the word gene. So therefore, I took a death moment called spiritual gene, and it's considered out there by my colleagues. Like my old theory, actually, I have this theory that you probably never heard of, that they also think it's out there. I insist that the karma theory is a biological theory. But I did it for 30 years, because I was so brainwashed to think, well, what is karma? Karma is like, you know, fate. First of all, maybe all you think karma means fate. You know, people say, well, that's not my karma. There's even an Indian novel called Karma Kola. And it's like Shehera, what do they call destiny? They call it that's Shehera. Kismet. Right? In our corporate culture, we talk about my kismet, right? That's my fate. That's my karma. Karma doesn't mean defeat. To Buddhists. Karma doesn't mean fate to fatalists. It comes from kur, which means to make or to do, the verb to make or to do, which is kur, which is cognate with the English word create. And karma means action. But particularly, the root of it in Indian culture is a ritual action in a Vedic ceremony. Isn't that interesting? Why? In a cultural era where they think that the gods are in control of your destiny, if you do a ritual in a good way, make a good offering, the priest recites the thing right, they make the right gestures, they do all the mumbo jumbo in the proper way, the liturgy, you know, the professional liturgist, and as a non-professional yourself, a layperson, you make the offering, and you have a biased attitude, that act will get the gods to act in your favor and will give you a good fruition. Do you follow me? So it's the kind, in the root of the language, it's the kind of action that determines your fate.
Sure.
Right? A ritual karma. So then Buddha took it out of the ritual setting. He said, everything you think is determining your destiny. Everything you say, everything you physically do.
Okay, just offer something
up. Yeah.
In that context.
Yes.
Given that you don't know that's necessarily all your previous lives, all of your actions,
right.
In this life here, you don't necessarily, you're living unconsciously, you don't necessarily know everything you've done or the consequences of it or how it was
right.
taken, these
exactly.
things. The result, the consequences that you experience in any given moment feel like fate.
Sure.
Because you're unaware of the basis.
The causes, right?
The causes.
Right.
Just for the student. Point that out, that you have a tendency to look at it in faith is probably perspective
right.
more than a belief that it is
right.
faith.
Well, but you know, the thing is that this culture is coming out of a very strongly monotheistic culture, you know, like authoritarian culture, the European cultures are. And, for example, the word understand means when you get involved, you understand. But what is it? But understanding, the thing about this, I stand under something. What are you standing under? You're standing under an authoritative, you're being obedient to an authoritative dictum. And you say, I stand under. Okay, I'll obey. That's what it is. The word in Sanskrit, to understand something, they use the verb to go. You go into a new world when you understand something. Adhikama, you go over something. You know, gate, you transcend something, you go out of something. So, because their culture was less authority oriented, more important, got into it, it was very authoritative in the beginning. So I'm just saying, that's right, and that's why we made a big fuss in an earlier passage about, I made a big fuss, not everybody else did, about how Buddha discovered causation. Right? I told stories and write about the whole idea of discovering causation and how powerful that is to get your fate back into your own hands by understanding the causes of what happens to you, to try to ameliorate what happens to you by influencing the causes by the way you act and by doing things and thinking things. And not feeling helpless that you have to get some intermediary to go tell the gods to not do this to you because you have no control over your fate.
That's
what Buddha discovered. Look into the cause.
Well, on that point,
perfectly.
Slight digression, though. It's not like it used to bother me how Menla Rinpoche, the murderer, becomes the first Buddha for the Tibetans, right? Because he's still on the issue of karma, because he still always was a killer. I mean, even a cop who has to shoot the murderers to save the other person's life still is a killer. I mean, we say, conventionally speaking, we excuse that because it's, you understand the circumstances.
Sure.
But it's still a killing.
Yeah.
Right? So Menla Rinpoche was still a killer. And so then the whole issue of purifying your karma,
what
I always thought was very interesting.
Yeah.
And I guess the way that I tried to resolve that was that you could never escape, as it were, the consequential nature of karma. That was, you know, you couldn't get rid of that part of it.
Right.
On some level.
Right.
But you could change the other side, the flip side, the other face of karma, which was your qualitative apprehension of it, your experience of it, how you liked it.
Sure.
You know,
right.
In the sense that, you know, so that you'd still suffer the consequences of the action. But they might not hurt you as much. You know,
they
separating, as it were, the injury from the insult, or the insult from the injury. Right?
I'm so not sure I quite get that.
Well, I'm just meaning there was just an attempt to try and reconcile the whole issue of Menla Rinpoche becoming enlightened in his lifetime, which he learned in 127.
Well, he said was about it himself.
I never bought the expiating his sins by beating on himself, flagellation.
Well, but what he said was that the reason that he was able to gain so much progress on the path was that he was in fear of the consequences of his having killed those 35 people out of revenge against his abuse that his family suffered from his uncle. And it was the fear of hell that gave him the energy to overcome all an obstacle. But you know, this is a hermeneutical rule in Buddhist teaching that's very important. That is to say, the only teaching in Buddhist teaching that is what they call definitive in meaning is the teaching of emptiness or selflessness, a pure negation, or a freedom, teaching of freedom. That is meant as it's stated. That, I mean, that's invariant. Right? Reality is freedom, in other words, which is a negative statement. That means the reality is not this structure or that structure or the other structure. It's freedom from any structure. Reality is freedom from suffering. Reality is nirvana. Reality, which is a negative, nirvana means extinction of suffering. You blow away suffering. So only that teaching is definitive, what they call definitive in meaning. All teachings about relational processes of things are interpretable in meaning, meaning they're only relatively true within a certain context, and they're not dogmas. So therefore, what that means is that when you analyze this issue of, since we've all lived infinitely, we've all done infinite good things and infinite bad things. So we'll never expiate, or maybe they cancel each other out, so we don't do so. Or you could say, we never can expiate the infinite evil. We don't need to if we have infinite good. In other words, it breaks down. And that's why they say that emptiness, any description of relative reality that you look to find some sort of absolute description of something that will be satisfying in the sense of this is really it, in a formula, it will break down under that thing, except the negation that nothing will be captured in a formula. That inconceivability will not break down.
Right.
That will liberate you, but it will not liberate you in the form of you can go around saying shunyata, shunyata. Because even shunyata will not be shunyata. Emptiness is not empty. It's all of this relationality is emptiness.
Right?
Emptiness is form, emptiness is matter. So that's a very important thing. That truths, therefore, which is actually very scientific, in a Popperian sense, Karl Popper, some of you may have heard of him, he's the one who, in sort of philosophy of science, said that all laws of nature are hypotheses that are the best possible accounts of the existing data and evidence, but they are awaiting falsification by better data. So there's no dogmatic absolute law of nature, and that's why we keep inquiring into the nature. Of course, scientists become very dogmatic about their ability to think of matter, there's no non-material, etc. I mean, they become very dogmatic. But according to really the definition of science as an inquiry into the nature of reality, infinite inquiry, to say, continuous probing into reality, in a way they you're agreeing with the Trinita idea that no formulation will capture the nature of reality, which doesn't stop you from formulating, it means that you have a limitation to how much a formula can do for you. And you're always open to seeing it another way. Like everyone knows, you know, Einstein made his breakthrough model of relativity by canceling what was a total dogma. Everybody was assuring everybody else that there was this thing called ether, which was like a fifth element, which was the medium in which all reality existed. You know, it was like the ether, you know, it was like some kind of substantial space, something like that, right? And he canceled that, he came up with relativity. Right, but that was what everybody agreed to, because it was a heretic of the scientific dogma of his time, and that enabled him to make a breakthrough. And I talked to them in an earlier time about my Rupert Sheldrake's book called Science Set Free, which I think is a way he does that. Although they are haunting and hunting him, the other scientists are so angry. He has this great talk on YouTube I recommend to you. It's a TED talk, actually, but it's on YouTube because it was banned from TED, because the other scientists are so irate. But the thing in it that I thought was especially funny was he discovered that the so-called constants of nature, 1.3 g's is the gravitational constant, 186,000 miles a second is the speed of light constant, there are these constants. But he noticed going around at different experiments around the world at different times and places and seasons, there's a variation in that. Nobody gets exactly those things. So they seem to vary in actual data. So he went to the Institute of Metrology in England, nearby Greenwich Mean Time, the timekeepers. And he went to the metrology, right, the study of measurement. And he said, well, what about this stuff? You say 1.3 g's, or I don't know if that's the right number, I forget, but what happened, 186,000 miles a second. But it just sort of never comes out like that when people measure it. And the guy said, oh, well, they just make errors. Well, how do you know it's an error? Well, because we set them. It's constant. Well, why is it constant? Well, we set it. We fixed it. Well, how did you fix it? Well, we just fixed it. With the Meteorological Institute, we said it is 186,000. We said it is 3.3 g's. So it is. And he was like, do you mean it's not based on a measurement? It's just your setting? So you're not going to look further into why there might be systematic error, you know, we suppose in errors? Maybe there's a small fluctuation in the universe. The galaxy is moving within some larger space. You know, the atom, you know, the whole universe is just an atom in one of those Samantabhadra universes of the Thurman and Ganden Thurman, right, that we read before, right? And so somehow that atom got squeezed in a chemical reaction in a macro universe, and therefore then there's been a life change. You know, like, you really guys are not interested? No, we fixed it. And that's your dogmatism. Anyway, okay, so the Bodhisattva's conception of the spirit is the will of great. I already said about it, don't even think about it unless you really feel you're here for the duration with all of us. You'll never escape from me, I'll never escape from you, and your mother-in-law, and whatever, your boss, your friend, your colleague, you know, Obama, W, Dick Cheney, we're here for
animals. Does this really have to be grasped rationally? I mean, just say, what about faith, for example? The idea that the apparent impossibility of liberating all these different people itself might be one of these, you know, relative dogmas. And you may not know exactly how to disprove it. You might just think, on the level of faith, that it is transcendent. How does that work?
The way that works is this, is that
something you don't.
You know my joke about little Johnny deciding finding faith? You
know, I love it. I think it's the best ever.
Everybody, I told you that joke already, right? I didn't tell you that joke? No? I thought I get pretty stuff. I'm sure I told that joke.
You have told
the preacher? Well, he knows. The preacher in the Middle West challenging the congregation. Can you all tell me what faith is? Who can tell me what faith is? Can I tell you this? No. Oh, good. You know, right. Who can tell me what faith is? And everybody sits silent. And then there's a little boy in the front row. He's like this. And he's the preacher. Come on now, you old grown-up people. Can't you know when coming here? You're part of the church. What faith is? Come on now. Little Johnny, look, aren't you embarrassed? He's always like angels always going to say what faith is. You all can't know what faith is. Nobody. He goes, he badges them for a while, and he comes in and says, okay, little Johnny, can you tell us what faith is? I can't, preacher. All right, tell all those good people what faith is. Okay, preacher. Faith in believing what you know ain't true. So that, not that kind of faith. And in the following sense, that we have, growing up in our materialist culture, going to science classes, reading Daniel Dennett, reading Richard Dawkins, reading Sam Harrell, all of these guys talking about the ridiculous, fanatical religious people and all those kinds of things. So we have a common sense feeling. Whatever, we might go to church, we might have this, we might not write, when Uncle Joe died, we have like the feeling, the ghost here thing. You know, whatever, we might personally have these things, but still, our common sense feeling is, all we are concerned with is our presence in this body until we run out of this body. That's all there is for us. We are acculturated to that common sense feeling. So, a belief in a future life is contrary to what we think is real. So it isn't believing what we know ain't true. So therefore, in a sense, it's a very weak take, that faith. Because it's a blind faith. It's a contrary to good sense, common sense, good faith. Now, Buddha is not against faith. We have faith. Faith is right in him. But he'll see it. But sensible faith. So what I always say about the Bodhisattva spirit, to really get the real conception of the spirit. Now, the conception of the spirit of enlightenment, you have to know in the Buddhist tradition, is like being born again. It is like, it's the Buddha's equivalent of being born again. And it's an odd kind of born again, because it's not a born again where somebody else has already saved me. It's a born again where, okay, I now realize that the really only way to live is for everyone else. It's like a heart turning inside out experience. And it's considered like an evolutionary leap in the sentient being's continuum, where they shift, which the human is uniquely capable of, where they shift from being primarily self-interested to being enlightened self-interested, where they realize that it is their self-interest to really be other interested. And that doesn't mean we hear about that, because of our sort of post-Christian, post-modern, materialist, Freudian, whatever we might think. Oh, that means you're going to go be a martyr. You're going to be like one of those people running after Pope Benedict or Pope Francis, or like, tell me some terrible thing about myself. I'm a sinner. It doesn't mean that. It means that I've come to, by examining and being mindful about how my mind works, about where the source of my pleasure lies in life, about where the source of my health, my vitality, my energy, I realize that it lies in what I can do for other people. Whether I physically am going out and serving soup to them or not, it's mental attitude. It's what I can produce in the lives of others that is really what gives me pleasure, if we actually examine what we get pleasure from. And if when we're worried, you all know this. When you are thinking that you want and need something, and you're focused on what do I want, what's in it for me, what do I need, what do I want, what am I going to get, that automatically is a description of you're feeling dissatisfied because you don't have it yet. So you're not happy because you got to get it.
You're wanting.
What?
You're wanting.
Yeah, you're wanting. So when your focus is on what do they want, the one thing that you've already done is you're forgetting about what you want. And even just forgetting about it cheers you up. Because you're not wanting it. You might then when you think about it, want it still. But for the moment you forgot about it. So then you feel cheery. If you examine the language of aesthetic experience, Did you enjoy the concert? Did you enjoy the opera? You went to hear Wagner or Carmen or whatever, you know, like Italian? You went to hear it? Oh yeah, it blew me away. Well, what does that mean, it blew you away? Oh, you were blown away because for a moment there, whatever it was, you were transported. What does that mean to be transported? You were not in your usual mode of wanting something that you didn't have. You just became absorbed in that music or that emotion or whatever it was. You forgot about yourself. Some kind of food even. What is the pleasure of the dessert? Was it chocolate? It's not that you, while you're enjoying the sweet taste, you're thinking about getting the next bite. The minute you just want the next bite, you don't enjoy the one you're biting. So when you think about other people, as the Dalai likes to say, the person who develops the genuine altruism based on the common sense about what really constitutes human pleasure, human happiness. The first person who gets happy when they're worrying about other people getting happy is themselves. When they're worrying about how happy they are, the first person who is miserable is themselves. That's just a law of nature. You can look in your own mind, you can find that out. I debated every year in reading Shantideva, another wonderful book. Maybe we should look at Shantideva the third time. Maybe we will the third day. We do right now, we'll look at Shantideva. You know, the challenge, I call it the Shantideva challenge. What does your real happiness come from? And because Shantideva says, all this happiness comes from wanting the happiness of others. All my unhappiness comes from wanting my own happiness, which is the opposite of what they say. And then I debate my students about it. They bring up different things. No, I got happy because I wanted this and that. We debate about what was the real happiness. When were they really happy? Well, they were happy when they forgot about what they wanted. Temporarily. Somebody wins a race. Then they go, wow, I won. By the time they're standing on that Olympic team with the medal, they are freaking out. They're thinking about training for the next Olympics. They're thinking about the ads and the commercials. Other people, if they only got silver, then they just thought they'd get the gold, and then not it. It's just short-lasting, totally short-lasting. The moment they get it, then they don't need it anymore, and then they forgot they want something. Then that's the only pleasure in the victory. Ask anybody who really wants something. And all the people, you know people who win lotteries? There's been studies of that. It ruins their lives. They end up losing all their friends. Some of them go broke. They go crazy. They break up their marriage. They have a terrible time, mainly, usually. There's a lot of studies. Okay, the Bodhisattva's conception of the spirit is a will of great enthusiasm, great initiative, great purpose, great outcome, and a dual objective. Second verse, I'm skipping that comment. The conception of the spirit is held to function on the Bodhisattva stages as faith, a pure universal responsibility. This is His Holiness, His great thing. Evolutionary impetus and freedom from the obscurations. Maybe, you know what, I'm not going to read this for the moment. I'll come back to this next time, because you have the handout. It saves me, and then I'll send you also the other page. You know what I'm going to do? Can I close with a meditation?
Sure.
I think that's the best way. I'm going to close with the compassion meditation. Okay, so go into meditation. Well, we have to have meditating in this class. I call it too much. Even though I'm going towards everything, my body's not going to work. But let's meditate. We're going to do the Asanga Maitreya meditation. Okay? Which all this leads to, in a way. We're going to do it with the Tibetans of synthesizing it. Okay, go into meditative mode. You know, which means that your eyes half closed ideally rather than completely closed, but if you're not used to it, you can close them. Choose to not get caught up in your visual field. There's also a half ritual field that's so boring, and then you're caught up and then yet it's open, but never mind. And breathing, actually sitting straight as a matter in a chair. This holding position that you won't feel uncomfortable in, you know, 15 minutes. Then, imagine, remember I think I told you in an earlier session, all the enlightened beings are in the sky, all the ones who feel amazing about them, sending you their blessings, full of light, I'm doing this quickly. Around you are all the other beings, friends, neutrals, and enemies, but all of them, an infinite host of living beings. And you're reflecting the light from these enlightened beings toward those beings. And within that setting, you're going to meditate the following. Due to the beginninglessness of life, you and all these beings around you have been born and reborn infinite numbers of times, countless numbers of times. And therefore, you cannot say with any certainty that you and every being have not had every conceivable interrelationship given in infinite, beginningless frame of reference. So with every living being, you've been in every conceivable relationship, bad and good. And with each living being, with an infinite number, the best relationship, short of them becoming a Buddha to you, biologically speaking, had been when they were your mammalian mother. And you can think of them as human, your human mother. Because that's the most selfless way a being is. Takes the other being inside its body, delivers it, cares for it for years while it's helpless, gives her life for it in many cases. So the mother is where that other being has been sort of completely most loving to you, whether even unenlightened mother or enlightened only as much as a human is. So this is called one of the six steps to conceiving the spirit of enlightenment. And this is the first step. It's called the step of mother recognition. And you can do weeks on this, or months, based on that sense of the infinite background, which you have to get your common sense into, takes also time. You know, infinite big bangs and big crunches in many, many universes, whatever. The fact that nothing comes out, that only nothing comes out of nothing, that every something comes out of something else. You have the beginninglessness of life, your life and everybody else's life. And so you can get to where you feel you can sort of admit. And this includes your enemies. Your enemies are people you highly disapprove of, you actually hate, historically Hitler or whatever, whoever's the worst person you can think of. They also were your mother in a previous life. In a big shock that they were. So then you do mother recognition. Then second step, you move to what is called remembering of kindness. Acknowledgement of kindness. Or just remember that. And here, if you can remember the kindness that your mother of this life showed to you, this is really a meditation of sentimentality. You succeed in this step when you begin to feel so sentimental about your mother of this life. Or if you didn't have a good mother relationship, whoever did take care of you, you wouldn't be a handsome, nice person here if somebody hadn't. You wouldn't even be alive. So whoever it was, in case some people had that difficulty, family difficulty, you sort of try to remember. If you can't remember that, you think of, you know, your wife or yourself as a mother, how you were with your child, or how your wife was with the child, or how your friend's wife was with the child, or your sister or somebody. And you realize the huge investment of love, passion, and energy, and intelligence, etc., that mothers devote to their helpless infants. And you get really sentimental about that, and you really weep about it. and you that sentimentality about your mother of this life, you diffuse of all your mother living beings, as they say. All my mother beings were so kind to me, they were so loving to me, they were so fantastic to me. And that's called then the third step. And you know you've achieved that, which could take weeks and months. But that shouldn't have to take too long if you really sincerely do it. It is said in the context of this, your wish-fulfilling gem tree, meditation shrine, mental meditation shrine, if you look back into your life and try to remember your childhood, it's just quicker than being on a shrink's couch. You can start really remembering early experiences. They will come to you in this meditational field, which is why good Buddhist shrinks like Mark Epstein and others, they use meditation with their patients to accelerate their recall of either traumatic or positive experiences in their youth. Jordan said, look at that. So the third step is called the gratitude step, where you then think, well, all these beings were my very kind mothers, and I weep to think of the kindness they've showed me over the infinite past. Life after life, giving me health and intelligence and a good body and protection and food and nurture and love and affection and God. How can I repay that kindness? How can I be their mother of what sort and make them happy? So a strong feeling of wanting to do something, just like one has for one's mother of this life, a feeling that one doesn't want her to suffer, or wants her to be well, etc. And then that comes on very strongly, a strong feeling of gratitude. And again, diffused over the vast host of beings around one. And then the fourth step is called the step of lovely love. And what that is one visualizes all of the beings one knows as being happy. One imagines them to be happy. One wants them to be. So love means the wish for the happiness of the beloved. And so it's a visualizing of all the beings as really happy. And when beings are happy, they tend to be lovely. They look beautiful. Their face is calm. They smile. Their eyes glow. They have relaxed facial muscles. Their posture is great. They feel relaxed and at ease, and they feel pleasure. And so they are beautiful. And so you see the beauty in all the beings in the fourth step. And then that leads to the fifth step. And the fifth step, it's called the step of compassion. And you become more realistic, and you say, okay, that's how they could be, my mother being. And then you try to bring to your mind specific beings that are either friends or enemies or neutral. And you look at them with their furrowed brows and their anxious looks and their facial tensions and things. And you see them suffering. And you realize that they do suffer. They are afraid. And you feel anxious. And you feel this is unbearable. You can't have them do this. You don't want to. The compassion is the empathy and the will to free them from that suffering. So it develops a very strong drive to do whatever it can need to be done to free them from that suffering. And then this leads to the sixth step, the final step, which is called the step of universal responsibility or messianic responsibility, where you know that you have achieved the sixth step. And by the way, each step keeps the other steps going. So it isn't like you leave behind the recognition of the mother, the remembrance of the kindness, the feeling of gratitude, the lovely love, and the universal compassion. They all come together they intensify each other, and they come together with your embrace of mental embrace of all the beings around you. And then you say, okay, I'm going to be the one to help all of these mother beings. I'm going to take this responsibility myself. I'm not going to say, well, Buddha should do it, Jesus should do it, God should do it, somebody else should do it. I'm going to do it. I mean, they should all do it too, all those beings, but they don't seem to be getting it done when I look around at all the suffering of the beings. So I'm going to do something that they are not doing. And then this sixth step, with all those six together, should make you feel actually a little bit crazy. You're like a mad person who's just got to do something for the beings. You're like wild with messianic fervor, with the enthusiasm of universal responsibility. You're like, in a way, because in a way you're kind of aware also of the fact that it's like it'll take you an infinite future to do it. But you can't bear to wait for that. So you want to do it sooner, but you don't know how that could be until you get very, very pumped up on universal responsibility. And then the seventh step, which is the fruition, which is the actual conception of the will to enlightenment, of the spirit of enlightenment, is where you say, well, wait a minute. There is such a thing I've been told, and it's come to make sense to me given an infinite evolutionary future, that there is such a thing as a perfect Buddha, a being who has fulfilled, who becomes the one, like Neo in the Matrix, but this is a being who has become the one in the matrix of infinite life. And actually, given infinite past, there are many infinite ones like that. And yet still, they don't seem to me anyway to have done everything for the beings that I know, that I adopt as my mother of the beings. So the only way I can really be able to help them have the power and the skill and the wisdom and the compassion to do that is to become such a Buddha myself. So I'm going to join the ranks of these Buddhas. And I'm going to take care of the ones that these other Buddhas seem not to have taken care of. And then at this point, one has this sort of heart turned inside out, opening experience, which they wax eloquent about in the tradition, about like a rising sun, like a blossoming lotus, like a elixir of medicine. They have 22 famous, like a rising moon, full moon, and they have like 22 similes that are famous of this moment in a being's evolutionary history where they really conceive the spirit of enlightenment. Although if you read the Vimalakirti, you will notice that sometimes beings have already done this in a previous life, or are human in this life, but they've forgotten that. And those kind of beings more quickly can do it again. You know, they get to get back to that because that is actually already in their nature. And there's a scene where he scolds the Buddha's son, who's telling them all to be monks, and he's saying, wait a minute, you have time. Remind these people that they already can see the spirit of enlightenment. They could be monks too, but they would be bodhisattva monks. There's a thing like that. So this is what a Sangha taught the Sangha. It's called the sixfold causal precept of the mother recognition, etc. And so these are the stages of the meditation that goes with these verses that we are reading, this text that we are reading. Okay, Dean, I want to close on that. It is 9. So I want to keep you off. It's a beautiful thing. It's very freakish. If you do it, even with the first step, if you bend in a little bit, all things happen to you. It happened to me. And that is, you start having deja vu experiences of people. Because what you're doing is you're going back in your own mind. You know, the infant, the psychologist, psychoanalyst will tell you, the infant has an imprint of the mother's face, which we've all forgotten. And if this isn't the mother that we quarreled with when we were adolescents, we wanted to go out and we wanted lipstick when we were 8 or whatever, or we wanted to drive our car and we were 13 or boys or whatever it is, this is not that mother's face. This is the mother when she was looking over your equipment And you were like completely like unindividuated according to Western psychologists. But yet the one thing that meant food, warmth, affection, nurture, etc., was that face, that adoring face going goo goo gaga. The goo goo gaga face. And that face, that we all have that imprint there, really powerfully. And so when you do that first color recognition thing, and the second one, remembering the kindness, and you work on those two in a meditation, you're going back in your own mind to those memories which are there, somewhere. They're all there. And then that face begins to sort of diffuse because everybody has had that face. Even Dick, I don't know if Dick Cheney has told me, he has, but he has a gay daughter. So he looked over at a crib sometime, and that Dick Cheney, who looks like one of those things in Jim Henson's Dark Crystal, one of those creatures now, but he had a mom, like a doting father's face. He did. And he looked with great love at this little critter now. He wouldn't have shot her face off with a shotgun before shooting a bunch of birds. He thought she was the greatest thing that ever was. And he had a wholly loving expression. So when you meditate on this, you then, that familiarity thing, so the word familiarity means like a family, familiarity. So you begin to, this familiarity face, the ultimate familiarity face is the mother's face. The childhood imprint that we lost track of. And then suddenly it pops up in other faces. And you're looking at some guy with a beard and suddenly looks like mom, subliminally to you. And my guru teacher in New Jersey was really that powerful. Because when I was meditating on this week's end, he would then occasionally send me into New York to see my mother of this life in her apartment. Spend a day or two, her, like, go help your mother, like, cook some soup for her, and I would have to take the bus and the subway, basically, it was terrible, 42nd Street, the bus station, walking through those tunnels to get on the West Side Drive, that subway. If there's a bunch of tunnels you go through, there's a massive people, faces coming at you, and they all look like moms, and I was like, you know, it was a terrible seeing them as totally familiar. It's like a deja vu. You know, you see, you meet somebody, you walk on the street. We were talking about that today. And you sort of think, well, I do know this person, but if I don't know them, I don't want to sort of come on to some stranger and think I'm crazy. And if I do know them, I don't want to slight them and snub them. So I don't know what to do. And you go through that thing, right? When you see some very familiar face, like I did the other day. So suddenly you do that with everybody. It's very that's why people go on retreat with me. But my teacher used to force me to go out in crowds. But everybody looked like mom. Mom. There's some weirdo with a beard. So it's like mom. Yeah. Okay, anyway, thank you very much. Good night. See you next week.